Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where this finds you, and a warm welcome to this third webinar in a series of events that UNIDIR is organising with our colleagues from UNODA and with the Friends of the Chair and the Chair's team. These webinars are intended to support ongoing activities of the BWC Working Group, and we're hoping we can stimulate thinking and discussion around a number of key topics during the intersessional period. You can find more information on the webinar series through the links that my colleague has posted in the chat. And at the outset, I should note that this event is being recorded, and we'll make the recording available online in the coming days. For this event, we'll focus on national implementation of the Biological Weapons Convention. And to explore this topic, we've brought together a panel of excellent speakers, and I shall begin that panel discussion shortly. We shall follow that with a Q&A session in which we welcome input from all participants to contribute. There should be should be able to find the Q&A function down at the bottom of your screens. And I should note your questions or any comments will be treated anonymously. But if you do want us to acknowledge you and to put a name to the question, please do put a name and or affiliation in the text box and I will read that out. Otherwise, I will not. They will be anonymized. Also, just so you are aware, as part of a change to our normal webinar approach, in collaboration with our colleagues in the BWC Implementation Support Unit and the Friends of the Chair, we have devised a short poll which we'll introduce at the end of the event. And what we want to do there is to get your input on some of the questions around things like what recommendation should come out on this particular agenda item of the working group. But we shall come to that shortly. Just a couple of words from me on national implementation. It's clear this is an extremely important topic and there is always going to be a division of labour between what happens at the national level and the international level when it comes to treaty implementation. I think it also, I'd for context, that this topic has evolved over the course of the evolution of the Biological Weapons Convention. And there's almost been a shift from a focus primarily around penal legislation to include a number of other possible topics which are linked to a national implementation. To give you some examples, we've had discussions on codes of conduct in 2005, discussions on biorisk assessment, I think, in 2008, and then a number of other related topics. So there's been an expansion, and I'd also argue that the implementation obligations extend beyond Article 4 as well. At the same time, I think there's also a recurring point within the BWC meetings is that there is no one-size-fits-all approach to national implementation and the context matters. So with that in mind, I'd now like to turn to our panel to elaborate on some of these points. And perhaps I can begin with Dr. Sonia Drobbies, who is a legal expert who's been working in this field on national implementation issues for several years now. She's a senior researcher with Vertic, among other positions, including a senior researcher position that she's taken up here with us at UNIDIR, which is we are delighted she has joined the team. So she's very well placed to take the stage for us and provide a picture of the current status of implementation and sort of the evolution, the development in how this is interpreted and implemented in the BWC context. So Sonia, thank you for joining us. The screen is yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon, and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak today. It is a great pleasure to join this panel on national implementation. So during the next 10 minutes or so, I will provide some insight, as you said, on the meaning, status, and strengthening of national implementation. First, to set the scene, let me start by clarifying the meaning of national implementation in the context of this presentation. The central provision of the Convention regarding national implementation is Article 4, which requires each state party, in accordance with its constitutional processes, to take any necessary measures to prohibit and prevent activities with biological and toxin weapons defined in Article 1 within its territory, under its jurisdiction, or under its control anywhere. Article 4 therefore includes an explicit requirement to implement the Convention at the domestic level, but the implementation of other obligations in the Convention can also be facilitated by the adoption of appropriate national measures. The scope of Article 4 is broad. It refers to any necessary measures to prohibit, but also prevent biological and toxin weapons. The prohibition of activities with biological weapons in penal legislation is therefore required, but it is not enough. The scope of Article 4, as is the rest of the Convention, is also broad enough in its wording to cover evolving lab science and emerging technologies having implications for the development and use of biological weapons, as well as for biosecurity. It is not always clear, however, how national implementation measures should reflect and adapt to those changes. In fact, neither Article 4 nor the rest of the Convention detail the types of measures that are to be adopted. This omission may be seen as an obstacle to effective implementation, but it also leaves room for agreed interpretation that is perhaps more reflective of evolving circumstances and takes into account national contexts. National implementation measures are of various types, as you said in your introduction, Jamie. Those include legal measures, but also administrative measures, judicial measures, voluntary standards, and other more practical measures. Let me now provide a brief and non-exhaustive summary of the material scope of national implementation based on the text of the Convention, additional understandings and agreements reached during successive review conferences and meetings of states parties, and practice as reflected in measures effectively adopted by states parties. National implementation measures include prohibition and related territorial and extraterritorial jurisdiction provisions. Another area is the safety and security of biological agents and toxins in laboratories, facilities, and during transportation to prevent unauthorized access to and removal of such agents and toxins. Another area covers education and awareness raising of those working with biological agents and toxins, which can be required or facilitated by legislation, guidelines, standards, and codes of conduct. Measures for disease surveillance, detection, and response in line with the international health regulations are also reflected in national laws and regulations. Another area to bear in mind is export and other transfer-related measures relevant to Article 3 of the Convention, which prohibits the transfer of biological weapons. This requires the adoption of related prohibition, but also effective national export control that are designed and implemented in a manner consistent with Article 10. Institutional arrangements, such as the designation of a national focal point, can help coordinate national implementation, as well as international cooperation related to the Convention, and may be facilitated through laws or regulations. As some of you may have heard during the webinar on confidence building and transparency held on Monday this week, legislation can also facilitate the submission of confidence building measures and the sharing of information on the implementation of the Convention. Let me now provide a few observations on trends and related challenges regarding the status of national implementation. Those are based on my experience, but also data extracted from the BWC National Implementation Measures Database developed by UNIDIR and VERTIC, which will be presented in a few minutes. At the outset, any reflection on national implementation should recognize that each state party's national implementing measures reflect unique national and sometimes regional circumstances and experiences. There are various approaches to implement the BWC, for example, through BWC-specific implementing laws, or a combined BWC and Chemical Weapons Convention law, or even CBRN laws. This can also be done through a sectorial approach with provisions in criminal codes, biosecurity laws, strategic trade control laws, etc. Some measures are placed in primary legislation, while others are left to regulations. Turning to prohibitions, a number of states parties have adopted prohibitions relevant to the BWC in their criminal legislation. A detailed analysis, however, highlights some challenges in adopting legislation that adequately reflects the scope and requirements of the BWC. Those challenges may relate to the text of the Convention. For example, some BWC-specific implementing laws do not include an explicit prohibition of the use of biological weapons, which is not explicitly included in the Convention, but is now effectively prohibited under it. It is therefore important to be aware of the text of the BWC, but also its evolving context, agreed understandings, and practice. Challenges may also arise when the implementation of the Convention is combined with the implementation of related instruments such as UN Security Council Resolution 1540 and terrorism conventions, including provisions related to biological weapons. There is a degree of overlap between the BWC and those instruments, but also complementarities and specificities, which should be adequately reflected in national legislation. With regards to export or other transfer measures, those are covered through strategic trade or dual-use trade laws, or alternatively, they can be included in BWC-dedicated laws or in a patchwork of laws covering plant health, animal health, human health, etc. Those are sometimes missing or partially covering a specific BWC-related purpose and hereby lacking appropriate related measures. With regards to biosafety and biosecurity, relevant measures can similarly be included in BWC-specific laws or laws on human pathogens, plant pathogens, etc., but not always with a specific biosecurity focus and not always covering all biological agents and toxins falling within the scope of the BWC. This creates gaps in securing peaceful activities with high-risk biological agents and toxins. Some countries have, on the other hand, adopted standalone biosecurity and biosafety laws and related regulations, more recently as a response to the COVID-19 pandemic. New science and technology issues are to some extent being reflected in a few countries' national frameworks for biosecurity, for example, with specific policies, guidelines, or codes of conduct to regulate dual-use research, or with measures related to cyber biosecurity. In that regard, secondary legislation or soft law may be more adapted to grasp fast evolving developments as regulations can be more easily amended than primary legislation. Finally, with regards to the institutional framework, as reported by the Implementation Support Unit last year, 147 states parties had nominated a national contact point, but a number of other governmental institutions are also usually involved in BWC-related matters. In a number of countries, institutional arrangements and information sharing related to BWC implementation are specifically provided for in laws and regulation. On the basis of this brief overview of the status of implementation and the challenges it raises, let me conclude with a few suggestions to perhaps consider during discussions on strengthening national implementation. First, and as suggested during the second session of the working group last year, the development of a clear and flexible agreed framework for effective national implementation could be an option to explore. This would be based on the text of the convention, a dynamic interpretation of the BWC in line with its object and purpose, and taking into account synergies, overlap, and complementarities with other relevant instruments. Secondly, ongoing awareness raising and knowledge sharing on national implementation is also important to conduct, insisting on the importance, but also the benefits of national implementation measures, including the adoption of appropriate laws and regulations. Thirdly, sharing of best practices and experiences can help further implementation, bearing in mind that something that works in a given country may not work in another, but can be inspiring. Fourthly, such knowledge and experience sharing could take place during and on the margins of the working group sessions through interactive activities conducive to the identification of lessons learned and recommendations. Finally, tailored and coordinated international assistance and cooperation is key to strengthen national implementation. This includes direct tailored support, and I believe we'll hear from ongoing initiatives in a few minutes. And there are also offers of assistance to take forward national implementation on the assistance and cooperation database maintained by the Implementation Support Unit. In addition, tools can be useful, such as databases, guides, gap analysis, and model legislation, a number of which are regularly being published and updated by international and non-governmental organizations. To conclude, I would like to reiterate that national implementation is an important part of the working group's mandate, and I would encourage additional working papers and initiatives to be submitted and debated on this topic. I very much hope that webinars such as this one will generate new ideas and foster discussions during the next session. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Sonia. I think that's a really useful overview of the scope of national implementation, the importance of the, I think you use the phrase, unique national circumstances and the wider context. And also thank you for adding some recommendations. I think I picked out five, but I suspect colleagues may also want to raise and develop some of those. We will open the floor for questions, but I would like to wait until we hear from all of our panelists before doing so. So with that in mind, I'd now like to turn to Mr. James Petty, who is a legal officer with UNODA. James is going to discuss some insights from national and regional activities in support of the effective implementation of the Biological Weapons Convention in Africa. And this includes international and regional support available for strengthening national implementation. So with that, James, the floor is yours. James, you're muted. Are you okay there?
Thank you, Jamie. Apologies for that. I just want to confirm before I begin that my presentation is visible to you all. Okay, great.
Can see you and hear you.
Yep. Okay, perfect. Sorry about the brief technical issue I was experiencing. Thank you very much, Jamie, and thank you to UNODA for the opportunity as well to present on some of the national support activities that are currently taking place under our project through UNODA. Aimed at strengthening the implementation of the Biological Weapons Convention in Africa. I'm going to spend the first few slides giving you a brief overview of the types of activities that we're currently implementing through our project to not only promote universalization of the BWC, but also to support states to meet their obligations under the convention. A number of those obligations were just mentioned and covered in quite good detail by Sonia. I will then spend the last half of this presentation, and provided I have enough time, covering some of the lessons learned and a little bit of the challenges and good practices that we have identified over the course of the last 18 months to 2 years implementing this project, which I think will tie in nicely with the presentation to follow from Janice, with whom we have also worked quite closely during the implementation of our project. So the project that we're currently implementing is aimed at providing assistance to all states parties on the African continent. I won't spend too much time on this slide, but we'll continue to the third one to highlight the fact that we are working with states not only on promoting universalization of the BWC in Africa, and are working with the remaining six states yet to ratify, exceed or succeed to the Biological Weapons Convention. But we also work at providing implementation support in the key areas that you see on the screen now. So this involves the provision of in-house legal assistance to states parties looking to develop or adopt national implementing legislation. As Sonia just outlined during her presentation, national implementing legislation can take a range of forms. So we work very closely with states parties to the BWC to work collaboratively to conduct assessments of their current status of national implementation, legislative implementation of the convention, and then work together to either develop a draft national implementing law or to put together provisions addressing gaps in existing frameworks, or simply to work with national stakeholders to review the existing legislative framework, to identify those gaps, to identify the strengths, and then to put together a sort of roadmap forward. So this doesn't only include support for legislative drafting and review, but we are also in the position to be able to work with states to support their adoption of the national implementing legislation once it has been drafted. And so this could involve sensitization of key government stakeholders, decision makers and parliamentarians on the importance of national implementing legislation and the need to ensure that legislation is adopted, not only to strengthen implementation at the national level, but to ensure that states are meeting those obligations under the BWC. We also work with states through training and capacity building support with respect to the preparation and submission of confidence building measures. We work with states parties to support their designation or establishment of national contact points. And we also work with states parties on issues related to stakeholder coordination. This could involve complementary training on the preparation of and submission of confidence building measures, as well as bringing together national stakeholders and various national stakeholders involved in the BWC implementation process to ensure that they are not only aware of their state's obligations under the BWC, but are able to interact with other stakeholders at the national level to raise awareness about their specific role in the implementation process and their obligations and responsibilities. So they're the general objectives that we're trying to achieve under the project. And we do so, as I have mentioned on the previous slide, through a range of different training programs, capacity building programs, and technical assistance activities. Now, in the interest of time, I won't go into each of those individually, but we do work with states parties through, we either work with them bilaterally or through regional and sub-regional activities that we have held over the course of the last 18 months to put together work plans and next steps, identifying the needs and priorities of each individual state, and then putting together a work plan that we then look to implement with each individual state in the region so as to offer tailor-made assistance with respect to either legislative implementation, the preparation and submission of confidence building measures, the training of national contact points, or awareness raising among key national stakeholders. So we're currently in the process of doing that now after having carried out a range of sub-regional workshops over the course of the last 18 months in all five sub-regions. You can see on the bottom right, the rationale behind conducting those particular activities was, as I mentioned, to have an opportunity to work with the states in attendance to put together these national work plans and next steps that we are now implementing in 2024. And we commenced this process towards the end of 2023. And you can see some of the activities that have already been carried out during this phase of the project. We have conducted awareness raising workshops and CBM programs, CBM training programs with the states parties that you see on the left of the screen. We have undertaken universalization outreach with two states not party to the convention and are working with, we have carried out three legal workshops with the states that you see on the screen, but we are working with a range of other states parties on issues related to legislative implementation of the convention, for which we have not yet put together legal training or legal drafting workshops, but we will continue to work with in the future. Just moving on now to some of the other issues related to the approach of the project. One of the challenges that I think we have identified throughout the course of the project, and I'll touch upon that on a couple of subsequent slides, is that we look to maximize complementarities as best we can. I think most of you will appreciate that there are a range of assistance providers working in Africa, and not just specifically in Africa, but working around the world on issues related to either directly or peripherally implementation of the BWC. And so we look to maximize those complementarities to the best of our abilities, and that involves coordinating with those assistance providers on a regular basis to ensure we either avoid duplication or maximize and capitalize on the complementarity that exists between various multilateral disarmament regimes or work being done, for example, by the World Health Organization, UNODC, UNOCT, UNICRI, and you can see the list on the slide there. I won't spend too much more time on this slide, and I think I'll get into some of the challenges and good practices that we have identified over the course of the project, over the course of the last 18 months, which I think will, as I mentioned, tie in nicely to the subsequent presentation that will be delivered by Botswana, which has a great deal of good practices and experiences to share with respect to national implementation of the BWC. I'll start by speaking very briefly about issues related to, or challenges and good practices related to, legislative implementation of the convention. The first point that I would make is that states are making progress with respect to legislative implementation of the BWC. States are have shown strong interest in the preparation of national implementing legislation, in conducting legislative audits, conducting assessments and reviews of existing legal frameworks. But as you will, I'm sure you will all appreciate, this is a slow process. So many states have drafts pending government review. And so we are looking to also work with government stakeholders to sensitize them on the importance of moving forward with this national implementing legislation. One of the other challenges that we've noted is that there are few comprehensive legislative and regulatory regimes that govern biosafety and biosecurity. There are some good pieces of legislation implementing the BWC, and we are able to then use them as good points of reference in our interactions with states that are looking to strengthen their national implementing legislation. But they are across the continent, in some respects, the exception. And so we're looking to work with states to put together a comprehensive implementing legislation that draws upon some of the good practices and experiences of regional counterparts and neighbors. And as I'm sure you all appreciate, there is in some respects, not only a lack of appreciation of the importance of implementing legislation, but there are competing government and legislative priorities. There are so many legislative sitting days or parliamentary sitting days in a given calendar year. And so in order to ensure that BWC implementing legislation is given the attention that we think it deserves, there needs to be sensitization of key government stakeholders and key decision makers and parliamentarians to ensure that there is appreciation for the importance of these laws. And just finally, the final slide, I've separated some challenges and good practices with respect to general implementation. And I've touched upon a couple of these over the course of the presentation, so I won't spend too much time on it because I understand that I am running out of time, so apologies for that. But there is, given the broad sectoral impact of the BWC, there can be challenges at the national level with agreement and coordination among relevant national stakeholders. So this is something we attempt to address by bringing stakeholders together to raise awareness about their roles and responsibilities in the implementation process. There are, of course, constraints. There are limited financial resources in a lot of the countries in which we work. And that isn't just in Africa, but it's, I think, a challenge that's shared globally. I think that there are also issues related to reporting fatigue that we have identified through our interactions with states parties. And so something that we try to do in our project, and we know that there is really good practice at the national level, is to look to ensure that states are finding complementarities and taking advantage of complementarity where it exists to ensure that work isn't being duplicated and that reports that are being submitted, for example, to United Nations Security Council Resolution 1540 are also being taken advantage of and used as sources of information for other reporting and processes under various multilateral disarmament regimes. And some good practices that I have identified on the right that we have identified through our interactions with states over the course of the project is that systematized stakeholder communication is critical, ensuring open lines of communication between national contact points implementing the BWC and stakeholders that are required to implement the BWC, whether they are aware or not of their direct role in the BWC implementation, is critical. Coordination between the various multilateral disarmament regimes is very important. We see a lot of good practice in various states across the continent with CBR and committees, with WMD councils that look to centralize this reporting process and this implementation process to ensure, again, that duplication isn't happening, but also that complementarity is taken advantage of where it can be found. And finally, and I'm sure Janice will touch upon this in her presentation, the importance of stakeholder outreach and awareness raising at the national level is something that we have identified in our interactions with states and is something that a lot of states are doing very, very well across the continent. So this is another good practice that we are looking to share with other states in the region through South-South cooperation. For example, we have Botswana attending a range of our activities across the continent to share their experiences with states parties that are at a different level of national implementation. And I'm sorry for having rushed through those last slides, but I was aware that I spent a little bit too much time on the initial slide. So I'm happy to answer any questions and apologies again for, I think, running a little bit over time. Back to you, Jamie.
Absolutely fine, James. Thank you. Really, it was an interesting overview as well. And I was struck almost by the importance of the human dimension in national implementation beyond the adoption of legislation. Many of those things, the socialization, stakeholder interaction, awareness raising, capacity building, I think there seems to be a real human dimension to this. And also thank you for ending on a positive note to share with people. That's always welcome. I'd now like to turn the floor to Dr. Jens Mogadi. James is the Deputy Director of Chemical, Biological, Nuclear and Radiological Weapons Management Authority of Botswana. And I'm hoping Dr. Mogadi is going to discuss the national experience of Botswana, the experience of the national authority, some of the challenges and benefits. So thank you so much for taking the time to join us. And the floor, the screen is yours.
Thank you, James. It's always a pleasure to participate at this event. I mean, sharing our experiences and getting other people's experiences is quite very important to us. My name is Janice, and I don't have control over moving the slide. Can you go into the next slide, please? I'll just go straight into it. Yes, our efforts. I will discuss with you our efforts in national implementation in accordance with Article 4 of the Convention, as well as obligation under the United Nations Security Council Resolution 1540. And I must say at this point that Botswana signed the BWC in 1972 and ratified in February 1992. Next slide, please. We have domesticated the Biological Weapon Convention through the Biological and Toxin Weapons Prohibition Act, which was enacted by the Parliament of Botswana in 2018. And it has already been amended, but this amendment was specifically for not necessarily the entire act, I mean, gaps. It's just specifically for proliferation financing, as it is part of what we do. And also, I may say at this point that we don't at this point not have regulations for the Biological Weapons and Toxin Weapons Prohibition Act. We have other complementary acts like the Chemical Weapons Prohibition Act, as well as the Nuclear Weapons Prohibition Act, which I will touch a little bit in the next, maybe next two slides. Next, please. I must say that our acts, the chemical, the biological, and the nuclear, they complement each other, and there are the five key elements has been touched, have been addressed: the prohibition, the responsible authority, the authorization or licensing, control, as well as enforcement. You can find them either in the Biological Weapons Prohibition Act or the Chemical Weapons Prohibition Act. Next slide, please. The CBRN authority for which I work was established under Section 20 of, Section 5 of the Chemical Weapons Prohibition Act of 2018. And this is the overarching act that has it has established this authority, which is responsible for the implementation of all the CBRN or the weapon of mass destruction. You can buy next. Next, please. This authority is established in the Ministry of Defense and Security. So we are an independent authority within the Ministry of Defense and Security. Next slide, please. So the functions of the authority is to it's an overarching agency in Botswana, which is responsible for the coordination, monitoring, and supervision of all activities specified in the three acts that I spoke about. It institutes measures for the implementation of United Nations Security Council Resolution 1540, the CWC, BWC, NPT, and other related international instruments. Both we do both solely. We cooperate with other public bodies, organs of the government, as well as non-governmental organizations within the country. Next, please. We also are responsible for the implementation of the requirements of a financial action task force. This is I have to mention this because it takes a larger part of our time in the implementation, in the running our authority. Next slide, please. So we have this international obligation. I've already spoken about the NPTs, the BWC, and the 1540. For this presentation, I'll be talking more about the 1540 because of even our name can tell that we are the CBRN. Therefore, there's no way I'll be talking about the BWC without talking about the resolution 1540 because they complement each other that manner. Next, please. So another effort in the implementation was the designation of the national contact points, which is housed in the national authority, which is us. It is the director and the deputy director by the virtue of them sitting in those offices. So we are responsible for other things such as preparation of the CBMs and coordination, national implementation, and communication with other state parties. Next. So once the authority was established, the focal point established, so we requested for assistance from the 1540 committee, which was very crucial in helping us implement the Biological Weapon Convention. So we had a series of workshops, and this was during COVID-19 times where the meetings were mostly virtual. So this was very advantageous for us because we could accommodate a lot of stakeholders in one room just through the virtual meeting. So we were able to sensitize them on the 1540. We introduced them to Biological Weapon Convention as well as the submission of the CBMs. We had South Africa and Kenya very instrumental in helping us establish the authority also in implementation of the convention. We also had VETIC assisting us by providing the legislative review, even workshopping us on the legislative processes involved during the identification of gaps, and that Sonia was very instrumental in this one. Next, please. So during this workshop, we realized that we need to come up with an action plan, which we'll be following to implement the convention. But this action plan was basically made before the 1540, but we extended it. We made sure that we included the Biological Weapon Convention in it, so that this action plan was very instrumental in success of the implementation of the convention. Next slide. And then the other thing was to identify key stakeholders at the beginning of the implementation process. So we came up with a team that was responsible for the action plan that I spoke about. So you can see that the slide here is color-coded. We have different teams. Those were responsible for the initial drafting of the action plan. And then we have the blue, which is now we have written BWC Working Committee, which is responsible for collecting the information for us to be able to submit the CBMs. So we have other smaller teams within the country. And then we have those that are responsible for the implementation of the proliferation financing risk assessment, which is another component which is, you know, discussing today. Next slide, please. And then we regularly submit the confidence building measures. And I understand that this was extensively discussed on Monday. Unfortunately, I could not attend the webinar on Monday, so I'll just go through, I'll just pass this one. So I just say we submitted our first confidence building measures in 2022, and we had never looked back. Next. So we also have local contact points responsible for helping us with the collection of data for the submission. Next slide, please. We also have the submission process for the CBM. Next, also the method of collection of information. So we have all these that assist us in the CBMs. Next. I talked about the NEP. This is the interagency cooperation that we highly have coordinate in the country. It is very instrumental to engage everyone who is involved because we took a multi-sectoral approach to develop the NEP so that it is owned by the country, not by the authority. So everyone who's involved in the implementation of the 1540 was brought to the table to come up with the action plan. So it was very easy for us to get people to do their part because we had involved them even in the planning of the actions, I mean the program. Next, please. We also do go through regional and international approach. I mean, I think James have mentioned that we've been actively involved in a number of activities. We've been even mentored Zambia and Namibia in how to just sharing them with them our experience on the implementation of the BWC. So we have recently participated in the at Geneva. We were at the side event. We have had bilateral discussion also for 1540 in terms of the import export exchange with Zambia with assistance from UNODC. So we've been receiving quite overwhelming assistance from the international bodies. Next. So our best practice here is we first of all start by identifying key agencies, which will also include the private sector. Once we have identified the key agencies, we establish buy-in by decision makers. So we talk to the CEOs, the managers, so that they can cascade the information down. So that way it's easier for us when we start demanding information or looking for one thing or the other. So we have had an intentional awareness and a sensitization process. Through facility visits, we do mandatory inspections. So during these inspections, we sensitize everybody what their requirements are for each institution. So we have decided that we will go institution by institution, talking to the starting with the CEOs, the managers, and then cascading it down to whoever is responsible for the implementation. We do media engagements. We go to local radios, even our national television. We've been there. We have consumer affairs like the trade fairs. We even advertise ourselves in the Facebook page for the ministry. So we try to reach even the person at the rural areas through the radio, the national radio, which can be reached throughout the country. So this one is very personal to us because there is very low awareness. So we do whatever we can to reach everyone. And we regularly update local contact points because we know people keep on changing jobs or being sent somewhere. So we regularly update and consistently and continuously we improve methods of data collection because it is not just writing to them to say we need this information. Sometimes we have to go to them to knock at their doors to demand data if need be. We also conduct skills audit to identify skill gaps, capacity, and capability. So we want to make sure that we have we do what you call CBRN material mapping through mandatory inspection. We want to know the skills that we have in the country. equipment that we have in the country, so that sometimes when we receive assistance, we know we matchmake, because we received assistance from 1540 through matchmaking. What we also do within the country, we also do matchmaking. If we receive any assistance, maybe be it a workshop or some trainings, we just do matchmaking within our stakeholders and direct it to them. Next slide. Of course, with all this, we still have challenges. There is still like inadequate awareness, because the country is broad, it's big, even though it's small, but we still have those challenges. We have those limited resources in terms of human and financial resources. I can just tell you that there's only five of us in the authority right now, but there is a whole lot that we are doing. CBMs mostly, when we do these CBMs, mostly limited to government agencies and parastatals, but we are roping in the private sector. We have started now going into the private sector. We started with what we saw as low hanging fruits. So now, it's only now that we have now penetrated the private sector. There's also a lack of synergies and resistance in some agencies. So we really have to massage them to have an understanding at the end. So that is why we have decided to go authority by authority or institution by institution, so that when we communicate with them, they see where we're coming from. Also, the policies and guidelines, we still don't have everything in place. We have been working on the Biological Weapon Convention, this review, since I can't even remember. We were very opt at the beginning. We thought it is something that will just take us a year or two, but I can tell you that even this year, I don't see it going to the parliament, especially that this is election year. I think next year we'll be able now to take it through to the parliament, because it's almost there. We are really at the very end, but this one has really humbled us, because the excitement that we had, we thought it was just one, two, three, but once it is out of our control, you just have to be very patient with it and very nice to whichever stage it is. And then we also have coordinated approach with regards to biosafety and biosecurity. I think this one is a challenge, a really big challenge, even with the Africa CDC and the BWC issues, and then us within the country. So we are still trying to come up with something that really will help us understand each other. Next. Okay, next is the priorities and next steps. The next step now, we have started preparing for the submission of the next CBMs. This time around, we really want to include a larger database that include private sector. We don't have a very big, really big market in Botswana as far as these are concerned, but we want to include everyone, because we have been working with government and parastatal mostly. So this one, for the completion of the, it will be completed this year, but I don't think it will go through to the parliament this year. Also, establishing a list of control agents or regulation of dual use material. In the next couple of days, and from 21 to 23rd, we will have a workshop that will be sponsored by Stimson Center, UNODA. That is now we are looking into the development of dual use material. So we will be having some people from OPCW, from IAEA, from BWC. I don't know if they didn't invite you or it's not of your interest, but I know that the BWC will be there. We'll have a number of experts coming to assist us in the development of the dual use. This is still part of the action plan. So we really have a lot going on, and we are hoping that by the end of the year, we will have at least a draft of the dual use equipment. And then in terms of establishing the regulations, I think this one is a bit far-fetched, because even the primary legislation is not yet ready. So, but we are just saying we are coming up with something, so that once we take the the primary legislation next year, then we already have something in place as far as the regulations are concerned. So we are just in the meantime working with guidelines and the convention. And then we continue to capacitate our stakeholders. And then we also would like to more resources, especially human resources, so that we can broaden up what we are doing. Also, we ensuring responsible and ethical research. We are also establishing the guidelines for research for them. With that, I think that will be all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, James, for what a really rich set of concrete steps and tools of participants here, covering action plans, stakeholder identification, local contact points, skills audits, and a number of things. And I think we all wish you every success with the next steps and the busy year ahead. We will be turning to questions shortly, but before that, I'd like to offer the floor for one last presentation to my colleague, Ms. Maria Garzón-Maceda, who is a project coordinator here on the WMD program at UNIDIR, and is going to provide a short overview of the UNIDIR VERTIC BWC National Implementation Measures Database. Thanks, Maria. The screen is over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Jamie. I'm conscious of time, so I'll try to go through this fairly quickly. I hope that many people on this event already know about the database. You might already be aware as well of the range of digital tools that UNIDIR has. And building on that expertise is that in August last year, we launched the BWC National Implementation Measures Database, which is essentially a one-stop shop for researchers, for experts, for officials that are working on the BWC, for them to find information on legislation and policy, on different approaches to national implementation. It has a global scope, so it involves all states parties, all groups, and all geographical regions. The database is a project that we undertake together with the NGO VERTIC and with funding provided by the United States. You can access it at bwcimplementation.org. There is a link available in the chat if you want to tag along while I briefly present it. Essentially, it's a searchable, publicly accessible database that contains information about the national implementation measures undertaken by all states parties to the BWC. It has profiles for all of the states parties and compiles the laws, regulations, other measures that Sonia mentioned before. The website is available in all six languages, and it has both browser and mobile versions. Before I move into the numbers, the database is designed to strengthen the implementation of the BWC, support policy processes, promote trust and transparency, cooperation in relation to the BWC, and also perhaps I should mention what the database is not. So this is not an evaluation of BWC implementation. There is no score, no ranking of implementation. It is not intended as a compliant assessment tool. Certainly, it is not a substitute for verification. So now moving on to this slide, I'm happy to share some stats. So since the launch, we have over 3,000 users from over 154 countries and growing. For a quick overview, this is the homepage. You can see there is an interactive map. We currently have on the webpage about 85 state party profiles, more or less the ones that you see highlighted in this map. We are adding more each month following an alphabetical order across regional groups. So this is essentially a long-term project. It will take us at least until the end of the year to complete all states parties profiles. And on the buttons on the left, you can see you can search by states or use the filter function. And I also want to draw your attention to the compare feature on the top menu, which allows you to visualize information side by side. And the search function is also available, which allows you to text search the content of the database, including in the documents, so the laws and legislations. To give you an example of what a country profile looks like, you can see the structure of the data is using one of the Friends of the Chair states for illustrative purposes. At the top, there is basic information, and below you can see all the categories, sorry, of data that we use, mainly the ones that were mentioned by Sonia, because we developed this together. In each of these categories, we have different details, which I will show you in a minute. But before that, I wanted to stress that we do take a broad approach towards understanding what national implementation measures entail. So we include not only things such as provisions or transfer controls, but also assistance and cooperation offers under the BWC. Or, for example, under biosafety and biosecurity category, we include cybersecurity measures that countries only started to put in place more recently, perhaps. There are not many of them that do have them, and they are not part of the Article 4 additional understandings or the 1540 resolution matrices. We hope that this broad approach provides enough breadth of information, but also helps future-proof the database thinking long-term. To provide an example, we can look at the governmental organization category for Thailand. So for each of the categories, we show a brief summary on top, in this case, the excellent example of the biotech agency. And then below, you can see you can click on the details section. The details are displayed below. In this case, we have two questions on the governmental organization for the BWC and other relevant organizations. You can click, perhaps going to another category, biosafety and biosecurity. You can see there's also the resources tab next to the detail, which shows you the relevant documents, mentioned legislation, acts, policies. You can also access links, in this case, for example, to the webpage of the Biosafety Association of Thailand. I don't want to take too much time on this. You can explore the database and other country profiles on your own. I do want to mention some important aspects. So when collecting data and publishing, we only use publicly available information, and we focus primarily on official sources from the state's parties. I also wanted to note that we provide the opportunity to each state party to review their information before we publish it by email or even organizing meetings if possible. And we normally apply 2 weeks time frame to receive feedback before publishing, but we are very happy to get that feedback at any time and make any adjustments after publishing as well. Of course, we aim to have a collaborative relationship with the states as well as other stakeholders, involve them in the process, and keep the information updated and accurate as possible. There are some examples of uses of the database, which I will not go into detail, but for example, as I said before, it's a transparency and information sharing tool. It also serves to better appreciate different approaches across the world. For example, signatory states might be looking to start the process of adopting national legislation and see what is the most convenient approach for them. The database is also meant to be a useful tool for BWC states parties, which might use it to identify which are the areas that require further strengthening, further developing or amending of the legislation. And finally, it can also be a tool to help shape assistance and cooperation activities or potential partnerships. It can also be a tool for researchers working on these issues, and we are very interested to hear your stories if you make use to the data of the database. So please do reach out and let us know. Very briefly, to wrap up on my side on the way forward, I do want to stress that we'll have an anniversary event in August, so stay tuned for that. As I mentioned before, we aim to complete states parties' profiles by the end of this year. And after that, we will continue to work on expanding the number of translated profiles and data. And we will keep updating each profile. Another thing that we want to do is analyze the data and provide reports and studies on the information by topics, by regions. And finally, we will also be looking to diversify and extend our funding for the future to be able to maintain and expand the database. With that, that's a wrap. You can explore the database more, and we welcome all of your comments and suggestions to improve it. If you haven't heard from the team already, we will be in touch with the national counterparts of states parties to ask for feedback on your national profile. And we will be very happy to always engage with you if you have any questions, either now or in the future. So thank you so much, and back to you, Jamie.
Many thanks, Maria, for the sort of whirlwind tour of the implementation database. I'm delighted, colleagues, that we've been joined by Ambassador Flavio D'Amico, the permanent representative of Brazil to the Conference on Disarmament, but particularly important for this event, the chair of the BWC Working Group. Ambassador, I want to turn to you to see whether you had any remarks you'd like to raise or any questions now. If not, we can wait until the closing part of the session, but I see your camera is starting, so that the screen is yours, sir.
Okay, thank you so much, James. Dr. Hevel has been invaluable in organizing those webinars, and we are dealing perhaps with what I believe is the most important issue on our agenda, which is national implementation. Actually, in a convention prohibiting a weapon of mass destruction, in the case of biological weapons, we are not seeking just a quantitative target in terms of universalization of the convention, but also a qualitative one. The strength of the convention, its capacity of addressing its objectives, is clearly very much dependent on the national implementation of the convention, particularly in the case of the BWC, in which we don't have many instruments for compliance and verification at the international level. So clearly we are dealing with something that is really absolutely essential. In our discussions, I believe we are dealing with national implementation might not be at the forefront of the political discussions, but it's very likely to be the greatest beneficiary of what we could come up in terms of new tools to make it more prepared to discharge its many functions. And we have been the presenters today, and I thank each and every one of them, Dr. Sonia Drobiz, Mr. James Pitti, Dr. Janice Mokadi, and Maria Garcon Maceda, for their presentations. They have highlighted the many interlinked aspects of national implementation. I wish to thank them. I would like to commend my group, my talented group of friends of the chair, composed by Ms. Atikan Dilogwatana from Thailand, Mr. Faith Pagamunda from Uganda, Ms. Griselle Rodriguez from Panama, and Michelle Carr from Australia, and also Mr. Reiki Ilahi from Indonesia, for all the work that they have been putting into this. So then in brief, I would say that the strength of the of our convention relies heavily on its weakest link, because this weak link would be one that could be used to circumvent the prohibitions contained in our BWC. I believe, in terms of challenges and opportunities, that many states, in fact, they face great challenges in translating treaty obligations into effective national measures. You can even have, let's say, regulatory frameworks in place, but we run the risk of having them being a dead letter unless we have capabilities in place. And I'm quite sure that what could come out from our discussions in the working group in terms of setting up mechanisms for international cooperation and assistance and for science and technology developments that are relevant to the convention will certainly improve the capabilities of members to implement that convention. So How can we support those efforts, and what practical steps can we take to ensure comprehensive and inclusive implementation across diverse legal and regulatory environments? And I think that during the presentations, Dr. Sonia Drobis has made this point about the unique national characteristics that need to be taken into account. Also, we have important challenges related to information available to governments. It's crucial one point that we have to have in mind is that we need to have enhanced quantitative and qualitative international exchanges of information under the BWC. And it's crucial to recognize that there is a fundamental challenge that extends beyond the scope of mere data sharing. And in numerous jurisdictions around the world, sensitive information pertinent to biosecurity is not yet readily available, even to the respective governments themselves, and even among the many agencies involved, as even in the case in point of Botswana, which is a model case of domestic organization, you could see the number of stakeholders involved. So this scarcity of accessible data poses significant hurdles to national security and then also to global biosecurity governance. So how could our discussions, that's the question that I proposed to you, our discussions focus on supporting these jurisdictions in developing mechanisms to collect, secure, and manage critical information. And then, of course, as I also indicated to you, the need for having an integrated approach between the agencies in charge of national implementation and the mechanisms to be developed with. I think that with those comments, I which actually go very much hand in hand with what has been presented by our panelists, we will certainly assist these very important discussions. And I do not want to take the floor for too long and prevent this time to be better used for the discussion with the participants. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ambassador, and certainly some further thoughts and questions for the panelists around how supporting jurisdiction and development of mechanisms to have a secure information exchange and developing that integrated approach. I want to encourage anybody, if you have written questions, please do submit these to the Q&A mechanism in Zoom. We do have a couple of questions which I shall start with now, and perhaps I can turn to you first, James. In addition to the question from Ambassador D'Amico, there's a question from Mohamed Zohaib from Aga Khan University, really querying the African focus of the particular project that you're talking about and some of those activities, and whether there is a plan to expand activities. And then also, I open this to all panelists, but there's a question on how can we better sensitize stakeholders to the key specificities and nuances of each regime. And apologies for my stuttering slightly there. But perhaps I can turn to you first, James, to take any of those.
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much, Jamie. And thank you, Ambassador D'Amico, for your remarks. With respect to the scope of the project, it's quite simple. The project, as you rightly point out, Mohammed, in your question, only involves states in Africa. This project was born out of several requests for assistance and technical assistance and capacity building support that came over the course of a number of years from states in Africa looking to enhance or strengthen their national implementation of the Biological Weapons Convention. As a result of this increasing demand, UNODA and then the BWC ISU started to look for opportunities to establish longer term engagement with states on the continent. And an opportunity arose with the Signature Initiative to Mitigate Biological Threats in Africa, which was launched by the Global Partnership Against the Spread of Weapons and Materials of Mass Destruction, the GP. in 2020. And so this was a timely opportunity to tie in requests for assistance that had been coming frequently to the BWC ISU from states in Africa, and an opportunity to develop a project through this initiative of the Global Partnership. That is not to say that there isn't strong demand from states parties outside of the African region with respect to technical assistance and capacity building support. There is, and UNODA, the BWC team in UNODA does have projects, for example, funded by the European Union that have scopes broader than Africa. But Africa is, the GP project is the only geographically limited project that we have, and this is the one that I work on and have presented on. As I mentioned, there is interest from states outside of Africa for a similar type of project to be made available to other regions. As yet, that doesn't exist, but this is certainly something that I think could be explored moving forward, given the success, the ongoing success of UNODA's Africa project. So thank you very much for the question. Back to you, Jamie.
Thank you, James. Perhaps I could put the same question to Sonia, or the question on sensitizing stakeholders, but any other follow-up to Ambassador D'Amico's remarks. But perhaps I could start with you, Sonia, and then turn to you, James. And please, Sonia.
Yes, thank you very much. And thank you, Ambassador D'Amico, for the remarks. Perhaps just a quick follow-up comment from me on this way to secure information sharing about national implementation. I'm perhaps giving an indirect response here, but as I briefly mentioned in my remarks, I think legislation has a role to play in this as well at the national level, and as we heard from Janet's presentation as well, to facilitate the gathering of information on national implementation and then the sharing of this information with other states' parties. So this is something that could be further explored to make sure that laws adopted at the national level facilitate this collection of information on the status of implementation and then sharing with other states. So just one quick comment from me on this. Regarding the question on the synergies and the complementarities between the BWC and other regimes and Resolution 1540, for example, thank you for the question and for picking up on this point, which I also mentioned in my remarks. I think one way to better sensitize stakeholders to those complementarities, but also differences and to some extent overlap, is to publish and have events to discuss those very specific differences in objectives and scope, because we often talk about the relationship between those instruments, but often in very general terms. So I think it's very important when you have articles such as the one that is mentioned that has been published in the 1540 Compass, for example. It's very important to describe those nuances between the different instruments in such publications. Another way, I think, to sensitize various stakeholders on those differences is to conduct James has mentioned his presentation, legal reviews, for example, that can really explain and show which implementing provision are coming from, which instrument they seek to implement, and what may be missing. And there are a number of tools to conduct those legal reviews that can help make the difference between what is being implemented under a specific instrument and what is being implemented under another instrument. I'm thinking, for example, of the 1540 matrices that have been developed to give an overview of the status of 1540 implementation, but also tools such as legislation survey templates that have been developed by Vertic and help identify which measures come from which instrument. Those are a few options to address the question. And I'll stop here.
Many thanks, Sonia. I think I've put the same question to you, Janice, as well. Please, the screen is yours.
Thank you very much, Jamie. Sorry, would you be able to just repeat what that question was?
Question to Dr. Mokgadi.
Okay, James. Janice. Sorry, apologies.
James, I mean, yeah, I get it. Thank you. Oh, thank you, James, for the question. Thank you, Ambassador Demiko, for those nice remarks. In terms of information sharing, I think I'll concur with Sonia that if it's provided for in the law, like the Chemical Weapons Prohibition Act, I mean our law gives us the authority to collect data and information from the institutions which are implementing. So it is provided for in the Act, so it actually helps us. So in terms of how we can sensitize the specificities and the nuances between the complementarities, I think for us, the name of the authority, like chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear, it actually speaks for itself that these are complementary. We have taken one authority that implements all the CBRN. So it makes us easy for us to when we do the sensitization workshop, because we don't go to them as depending on what we want to discuss, because we come from the CBRN authority. Clearly, it will show that we are implementing CBRNs, and these are complementary in nature. The 15-fold, that is why even our NEP, we don't have an action plan that is specific to Biological Weapon Convention. So we took the one that is for the 15-fold because it encompasses all of them. So we have because it implements, non-proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, which is the CBRNs. So from the beginning with our interagency cooperation, we took a deliberate action that, okay, let us have the one that addresses all, rather than having the BWC on its own, the CWC, it's all in one action plan, even though we know that we are looking at different regimes. So I think in a way it works for us as we go to the institution that is maybe responsible for chemical materials. So we talk to them, but we also bring in the biological aspects, because even the our act that establishes the authority is the Chemical Weapons Prohibition Act, but it also talks about the Biological Weapons Prohibition Act as well as the Nuclear Weapons Prohibition Act. So already the law, even though we have the Biological Weapons Prohibition Act and the nuclear, we also have the one that also includes them. So because we were unable to differentiate them, we just thought they are complementary in nature. The authority itself, I mean, the five of us, we implement the Chemical Weapons Prohibition Act as well as the NPT, as well as the BWC. So I think by having the authority, for us, having the authority that implements all this, assist us, sensitizing them. We show the complementarity that right now we want to come up with a simulation exercise, and then the decision was, are we going to have a simulation for biological or for chemical or for nuclear or what? But then we come up with a plan. But the plan will be similar, whether it's biological, I mean, the response plan will be similar in niche. So that is how we approach our stakeholders to show the complementarity. I don't know if I really made sense.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Magadi. I'm slightly conscious of the time, but I did want to, there's another question that's just come in on, I should also say that last question came from Katie Carroll from Unicree, and I think you have the link to the recently launched 1540 Compass e-journal, which deals with many of the issues we've been discussing today. But just moving forward, I have a question that's just come in, and I'll put this to you, Maria, but if anybody else wants to follow, the question is, how can we help prepare states for emerging technologies and relation to national implementation? And do we need almost a unification of the threat perceptions here? And perhaps you could take that, but anybody else welcome to follow up after Maria. The screen is yours.
Thank you, Jamie. How we can help? Okay, so essentially what I can mention is the relevance of the discussions and the decision that state parties took during the last review conference to discuss with a view to establish an S&T, a science and technology review mechanism for the BWC. And no matter the size, the composition, which form this mechanism will eventually take, essentially it will be tasked at looking at the emerging technologies and the implications for the BWC. And may I mention, this entails not only but so both the benefits that new technologies might have, for example, for verification, and also all of the challenges, and see how states parties can be prepared and implement legislation at national level, but also activities they can take forward and the international level. For this in particular. A few days ago, we did have a webinar focused on just that, so on this S&T mechanism with lots of information, so I will not expand more on this. The recording is available online, and you're very welcome to go and watch it if you missed it. Definitely, I would recommend.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Maria. I think it's also another reflection of the interconnected nature of some of the challenges that we face in this area. We have a poll system which I'd like to try out, and I would ask all of you, please do bear with us as we test the technology here, because things can go wrong. But what you should see coming up on your screens soon is a first almost tester question where we work out your affiliation. And then we'll have two more questions which we've developed with our colleagues, the Friends of the Chair, and with our colleagues over in UNODA. And we really want to get your input to this. So if I could encourage you to start with a simple question on your affiliation, your identity to begin with. And if people can just test that works and people can begin to fill that in. I'll give you a minute or so. I'm not sure whether I should be able to see something different here on my screen. Perhaps my colleagues from the production team can advise me. Ah, okay. We have an answer. Great. Okay. So we actually have four questions. I'm not sure what you're able to see, but on the first one is your affiliation. Then if you're able to scroll down, and please let me know if you can see different things here, one of the production team. There is a question on the scope of national implementation. I encourage you to tick all those that apply. And then we have a third question on what sort of recommendations should be produced by the working group on the agenda items related to national implementation. See, that's people are starting to complete that. And there's space for open text right at the bottom in question four, where any comments, questions, or points you want to raise, please feel free to do so. Okay, I'll give people a couple more minutes to fill those in. And then what I plan to do is to turn to the Friends of the Chair, I think beginning with Michelle, and then turning to Athakan. But I'll give you another 2 minutes to complete that, and then we'll. Okay, perhaps if I give people another 30 seconds, just because I'm not good with uncomfortable, awkward silences, and so we can move on to some closing remarks. Michelle, I'm not sure whether you're able, Athakan, I'm not sure whether you're able to see the results of the poll, but I'll leave it to you as to whether you want to build on those or use those in your remarks. And perhaps while people are finishing that, I can turn to you, Michelle, first to provide some closing thoughts from your side, and the screen is yours.
Thanks very much, Jamie, and let me thank Unity, our esteemed panelists and all participants who joined us today. I also wanted to say a special thanks to Ambassador D'Amico for steering the working group process and for his thoughtful remarks today. I think as we've heard, national implementation is a critically important topic, and it's one with an inherently cross-cutting nature. Although this topic won't be formally discussed in the working group again until 2025, given its cross-cutting nature, I think it's really important to keep this topic front of mind throughout our discussions. I think today's webinar has really helped to inject some new ideas and stimulate thinking on concrete recommendations which the working group could consider devising to strengthen national implementation of the convention. While I won't attempt to summarise all views and perspectives that we heard today, a few ideas and themes that came through are that national implementation involves a range of measures, including legal, administrative, and judicial measures, but also voluntary standards, codes of conduct, and other practical measures. We heard that there is no one-size-fits-all approach to national implementation, but there could be value in having a clear and flexible framework to guide comprehensive national implementation, taking into account diverse national and regional experiences. We also heard about the importance of tailored and coordinated international assistance to states, helping them with their national implementation, and about the value of sharing best practices and experiences. Jamie, I can't see the results of the poll you just conducted, but I eagerly await those results. I'll stop there, but my colleague Athakan will also be offering some concluding reflections, as well as outlining the next steps of the Friends of the Chair on this topic. Thank you.
Many thanks, Michelle. Indeed, over to you, Athakan. The screen is yours.
Okay. Thank you so much, Michelle. The Friends of the Chair, which also to thanks for your active participation again, and the thoughtful responses provided today are very greatly appreciated. All information and the comments that we gather from this exercise, whether it's going to be during the Q&A and also from the poll that we will see the result soon, will be utilized in the subsequent steps that our team will undertake. So we are so glad that some of the views that mentioned by Mitchell was coincides with the elements that we took from the discussion during the working group sessions. And also what we would like to do is we would like to continue working together with states and other stakeholders to ensure that our collective endeavor will help strengthening and reinforcing our endeavor under the BWC. We will organize an online consultation on the 31st of May based on the Food for Thought paper that we already circulated earlier this March. And we also will take the views and comment today into account as well. The time and technical arrangement will be shared by the BWC ISU in due course. Apart from the consultation, the Friends of the Chair are remain open to bilateral meetings, and we also encourage all to submit working papers on this subtopic so we could gather your views and reflect them in the recommendations submitted at the end of this year. And thank you again.
Thank you very much, Athakan, and thank you to your fellow Friends of the Chair as well for your collegiate collaboration in the course of setting this up. It's been greatly appreciated. Ambassador D'Amico, if you would like to have the last word in the discussion, the screen is yours.
Yes, I don't have much to add, James. I think that The discussion was very rich and has shown the many aspects of national implementation, and of course the fact that for it to operate properly, it has to be, we have to have an integrated approach. Now we are looking forward to the food for thought paper from the friends of the chair, and that a good discussion be held so that we could trace a roadmap as to how we are going to come up with some sort of conclusions by year's end deliberations. Thank you.
Many thanks, Ambassador. Just before a closing point from me, could I ask my colleagues from the production side if it is possible to show the results from the poll? If not, we can circulate them via social media to register participants in this discussion, so we will get them to you. And just before closing, without wishing to overwhelm you with polls, we do have an online feedback form. This takes a couple of minutes to complete. It is anonymous, and you can find the link in the chat, but also the QR code there. This is really useful in terms of moving forward and perhaps thinking through other topics to work on, but other ways we can improve our events. And just remains to thank all of our speakers today, to our UNODA colleagues, the friends of the chair, as well as Ambassador D'Amico and the Brazilian team that we're working on this. And thanks to our colleagues who have supported the production of this event, specifically Maria, Clarice and Lewis Horn, who make these things work behind the scenes. So thank you very much as well. And finally, thanks to all of you for joining this event. This is the third in a series of webinars we're organising. The next one we'll have takes place on the 13th of May, 2024, and we'll look at compliance and verification. So I hope to see some of you there for that. But in the meantime, have a good afternoon if you're here in Geneva, or a good day, night, depending on where this finds you. Thank you very much.